A close-up look at animal welfare issues is supported by animalwelfareissues.com.
You are watching A Close-Up Look at Animal Welfare Issues with your host, writer, speaker, and advocate, Tina Evangelista-Eppenstein. This show is supported in part by animalwelfareissues.com, spotlighting issues around the globe. Check out the latest TV shows, articles, podcasts, and more. That's animalwelfareissues.com. Now here's your host, Tina, in 3, 2, 1.
Hi, I'm Tina Evangelista-Eppenstein, and thanks for tuning in. Well, right now we're officially in the spring season. However, I mean, we've had fall-like weather and we've had summer-like weather, but we are officially in spring season. And along with spring season comes along baby animals. So what I'm going to talk about tonight, is it to rescue or not to rescue? That is the question. And my guest and I are going to talk about what should you do if you should come across a baby animal, or some other animals for that matter. And you'll meet my guest in a moment and you will recognize him. But I also wanted to tell you to stay tuned. In the second segment, I'm going to do a tribute to the military animals who have served our country. Monday is Memorial Day, and there are parades and observances all around the country to honor our fallen men and women who have served in the military. But I want to take this time to honor all the military animals that have also lost their lives fighting for our country. So stay tuned for that. And parents, there's going to be a little animated segment in there. It's a new movie that's out, so I think you want to stay tuned for that because it's like it looks like a really cool movie. So first up, let me introduce my guest. Well, he really actually needs no introduction. He's my husband, Ed, and he's been on here before. And on the last show, I talked about a cat that he rescued. And if you could put that picture up with the cat. There's the cat. Just one second. I just want to briefly go over this. You rescued this cat a few weeks ago, and he was, what, 25? Then he went 35 feet up a tree, and you rescued this cat.
Right.
Okay. And, you know, you're the only one who was able to successfully get this cat down. I mean, this was a tough task to do, to start. I mean, and this is your first time getting a cat that was stuck in a tree.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, but on that show, my previous show, I talked about how you rescued other animals, okay?
Right.
And but you and I have rescued, saved,
many,
and worked with and taken care of a lot of animals, okay, over the years.
Yep.
And we've done a lot of this. Very, very briefly, can you just mention some of the atypical animals that you have helped through the Reading School District that you've helped save that some people may not think?
Yeah, we have a lot of surrounding woodland, Hamden Park abuts Reading High, so we get a lot of different animals that come down on the fields. Not only that, they find their way into the school every once in a while. And believe it or not, there's raccoons in the city, and a raccoon actually found his way into 10th and Green over the summer. This was like, into the school. Somebody left the door open and it walked into the school. So I had to get the raccoon out, and that was in the middle of the day, so always you have to remember it could be a rabies situation. The safety of the kids come first and the staff.
Right.
So if there's an animal in there that causes a disruption in classroom, which it does, you know, if a bird flies through the window and is flying around, you got to get the kids out, get the bird out as quickly as possible and back, you know, out into the wild.
Was this raccoon safe? Was it rabbit?
I don't know. Now see, with the license I hold for the district, I'm their pesticide applicator along with being the arborist and things, okay? But my determination was to get it in a trap, which I did, and then get it out of there and take it up and release it back into the wild.
So you have no idea if it was rabid or not?
No. The only way you would find out if it's rabid is to observe it for like 10 days or either put it down.
But it didn't do anything out of the ordinary.
No. It wandered in. I don't know if...
It wasn't acting strangely except that it wandered in.
The strange thing was it was in a strange environment, so it acted strange that way, but no.
Because raccoons can be out during the day,
yeah,
even though they're nocturnal animals.
If they run the sewer system, so if the city was flushing fire, you know, hydrants, it could have came out of the sewer and then just seek shelter, and there was an open door and it came in.
So someone else, let's see, you know, a raccoon, it would be best to call what, the game commission or a wildlife rehabilitation
specialist? Yeah, raccoons really shouldn't be out during the day. And if they're acting weird, if you see a rabid raccoon, they'll walk in circles.
Yeah,
they'll act like they're playing with something that's not even there. And they have 10 days to live before their brain swells to the point where they will, you know.
They can attack.
And they can attack.
One has already attacked your dad's
my,
dog.
We lived in the city and my dad had his beagle out back. And
just on the porch.
On the porch, and he heard screaming and carrying on, and he went out and there was a raccoon latched on the back of the dog's leg. And that was, and he beat it off with a chair and he killed the raccoon.
So anybody who sees a raccoon, who should they call?
This is where it gets a little,
the game commission.
And maybe the game commission can send somebody out. The police don't want to handle wildlife and
right.
And the different rescue groups don't want to handle wildlife.
Right. You've handled deer. I just want to list some of the animals because
right.
I want to get on to the first animal we want to talk about.
Deer, possums, hawks that have hit the windows and have injured themselves and I had to take to Red Creek. Dogs that are either follow the kid to the building and they let him in or they're chasing him outside, which can be a dangerous situation. So there again, it's safety of staff and students. So you get the dog out of there, you know, and then take it to the proper, you know, rescue or whatever to find out whose dog it is. It's not a good situation when you have a lot of kids and a lot of activity and you have a like a pit bull or any big dog running around and they can get confused and they can get aggressive just through the commotion. They're not used to that. Bats are another one. Bats in schools, for some reason bats can get into schools very easily. And the next thing you know, somebody's walking down the hall and they see a bat stuck to the side of the wall or hanging from the drop ceiling. So, and bats are very high in the rabies category. So there again, there's a simple way of doing it. You know, you get up with a ladder, usually they're hanging and you take a coffee can, put it on them quick, and then you slide a piece of tin or paper and they lose their footing and they drop in the can, you take the can outside and you release them. And you wear gloves because you don't want to touch, you know, anything that they've touched.
Okay. And bats can also carry rabies.
Yes.
So you bats, don't want to.
Bats are really high on the list for carriers of rabies.
Okay. So you brought up opossums. And we've helped some babies, but I just want to quickly show like 30 seconds of a video. I want to see if you know how the babies walk around with the mom. If you can show that clip.
Wow.
Okay. Yeah, what age are they when they're...
They're getting ready probably to leave the mom. Obviously, she's getting like, you know, you're getting heavy, get off of me. This is getting old quick. Now, we had a situation in our backyard that you could say about.
Well, I'm going to show the picture.
Okay.
I just wanted to show the people watching this.
Right.
You know, if they've ever seen this, because it's not, I don't think it's a common sight.
No, and if you don't know it, possums are marsupials. So usually they carry the babies in a pouch until they're old enough where they crawl up on the mom's back.
They're with her for quite a while, because I think they're in the pouch for, 4 months?
They're in there for a while, and then what happens is if they fall off of her when they're too little, then they can't climb up, and that's when they have to go to a rehabilitator.
Right, and that's what I wanted to bring up after this video. I have a picture also of the baby possums that we had, if you can show that as well. There.
Yeah.
Okay, those are the baby possums.
Right, now they're a lot smaller than the ones that were on the back of that female.
Right.
So they would have to go to a rehab.
But there is a rule of thumb with possums. If they are 7 inches or shorter, and that's from their top of their head to their back end, they need to go to a wildlife rehabilitator. If not, that means they already did fall off their mom.
Right.
And they are afraid to go on their own at that point. And that's the point I really want to get across because I think people may be confused, you know, it's like you see a baby possum, you know, what do I do with it, you know? Because once it's old enough, like it passes 7 inches, that possum can take care of itself, correct?
Right, correct. They're on their own.
But
you know.
These two, we took to Red Creek.
Yes, and they did an examination. They said they were healthy, they weren't dehydrated, and they were going to raise them up until the proper age and then release them.
Yeah, and they said they did do fine then, and they did release them. So
the neat thing about Red Creek is when you take an animal there, you can check up on the progress.
Yeah.
And they'll give you a release date and tell you how everything went.
Yeah.
It's a great organization if you have any questions or if you're in need of somebody. But
they really are
top notch.
Yeah, they're a great big help. They've been on the show, and we've been up there now many times with different animals. What's the next picture? Can you show me the next picture?
Okay. Now these are bluebirds in a nest.
Right, and I just want to say these two. Are there two bluebirds? The regular color bluebirds.
Yeah, there's two blue.
And then two leucistic, which means they're white bluebirds, except the color of their eyes are brown.
Right, they don't have the albinism in their eyes, which really would make it hard for them to survive.
And these are birds, though, this is a rare occurrence because you have this bluebird box.
For some reason on this property where I run a bluebird trail, and I've been in touch with Jack Holcomb, Terry Gerhardt, and Lebo, and this is very rare, but I've been getting leucistic bluebirds. It's in the DNA down there, and it's running through the genetics of that area, and this was last year. We got two more. We're up to seven over the past 10 years on that property, which is really, really
seven
rare.
Seven total white.
Yeah.
And that is a really rare occurrence, but I just want to talk about the bluebirds we took in, was it last year or the year before?
The year before.
It doesn't have anything to do with this nest, but this is what we wanted to show you. Baby bluebirds that in another one of our nests on our property where the mother died, we found her deceased. There were five babies.
Right.
And five were too many for the father, because the fathers do take care of the babies. And we spoke to somebody who knows all about this. And so we took in two while the father raised a three. And we took care of those bluebirds around the clock. I loved it.
It was really a learning experience. I don't know if many people know, but birds usually get their moisture through what they eat. You can't feed...
It's really important that they
have
water.
Yeah, you can't feed liquids to a baby bird, because what happens, it misses
moisture
gets in the lungs.
That's part of their nutrition, like you said.
So we did blueberries for the moisture, mealworms, and we did cut up egg whites, very small.
I don't remember all of that.
Yeah.
But I know I was feeding them around the clock.
Right, around the clock. And then what happened was, as this progressed, I came home the one day, and the male that was outside calling the young ones out, and they were going to fledge. And we're like, uh-oh. I ran in the house, and it's like the other ones in our house were ready to go.
I told you that. Right. It's like they're trying to climb out of here. It's like, I think it's time.
Right. Now, that male would not be able to raise five, so we gave, like you said, and we supplemental feeded as far as we gave him worms, mealworms, to help so he wouldn't have to hunt so hard.
Right.
So now that with the two birds we had, we obviously couldn't go and teach them what they needed to know. Then they went to Red Creek.
Again.
And Red Creek had a flying pen, and they had other birds, bluebirds, in that same category. So then they kept us abreast of when they were going to release, and everything worked out great.
I know. I mean, that was great to watch them, and we have the pictures. I just couldn't find them, so I'm sorry, but I mean, they were adorable.
But it's a commitment. It's
nothing. Oh my God! Yes,
it's nothing you take in lightly at all.
Yeah, if you have to know what you're doing, and otherwise take them like to Red Creek or to a wildlife rehabilitation center. But we knew what we were doing, and like Ed said, I mean, we were committed to this. So and we stayed committed, and it was great. You know, I loved it. I want to bring up mallards now, and there's a lot of baby mallards out there.
Right.
And this is going to go to you. In the Reading School District, there's just more than one female. They constantly lay eggs at this one school, and you're constantly being called because they can't get out of this courtyard.
Right. Yeah, they're landlocked in a courtyard. It's funny. She knows she's safe to lay the eggs in there, and what she does, she lays the eggs. And when they hatch, we put a little corral around them so they can't go too far. And then we catch them, and she knows the routine. I say, let's go. I grab the box of babies, and she flies off out of the courtyard, lands on the other side, and waits for me outside the door. And then we go walking down to the Y Missing Creek, which is a block and a half away. So at a block and a half away, I get the babies, and she flies over my head, dives into the creek. I dump them, she takes them, and heads down towards the river.
But this isn't always an easy task to do. It sounds quite easy with what you just said.
And it's a yearly event, but this year was really unusual because the head custodian there called me up, and we had two ducks at the same time nesting in the same courtyard. So obviously one of them was the one I always did it with, and she knew the routine. The other one, I didn't know. She didn't know. So when you get the babies out, she keeps looking back at the courtyard when I get her finally the fly on the lawn, and I have to keep showing her the babies, you know, and make them peep. And then she follows me so far, and she keeps looking back at the school. If you don't keep her really invested in it, she'll fly back to the courtyard looking for them, and you have them in your hand in a box.
You think she was a brand new mom?
Yeah,
like
because
first-time
yeah,
mom?
The other one knew the routine. She knew what door I was going to come out, and she was waiting for me. And she headed towards the creek, and we walked behind her.
Yeah.
It's amazing. I mean, and that was, their memory is just so good, and people think they're super smart. They have a memory that, and they know what you did a year ahead of time. And they only do it once a year, as far as they go through this once a year, but it's so etched in their mind that she knew exactly where we were going, she knew the routine, and she waited for me, and we walked down through, and everything worked out perfect.
But it's already happened where that you've had a mom that didn't even care.
Yeah, sometimes you get a new female that is abandoned. One of the females we had for 6 or 7 years, so you know that was an older hen, and then all of a sudden, another one shows up, and she just doesn't look the same and doesn't act the same. And what it is a new hen, and she has no idea what she's doing. And sometimes they panic and take off and don't come back. So then you're stuck.
And that happens with other species of animals.
Right.
You know, for whatever reason.
That's why with your title, like you said, knowing when to, you know, rescue and when not to, there's a lot of wild animals that are taken care of by their parents that are in that situation because that's where they put them.
Okay.
So what you have to do is, you know, you really have to, it's a long list of experience of knowing when to rescue, when to leave it alone and to walk away.
And mallards, they are protected. They're fairly protected.
Right.
So, I mean, you can't raise them.
No.
You can't do anything.
Even rescuing, they probably would have a problem with, but they're in a courtyard. I have to get them out of there because of hawks and there's no food there. They need aquatic insects and plants. If I get them down to the creek, the mom follows them and they're all gone. That's fine. Everything worked out perfect. So I don't think anybody should have a problem with what we do because we do it every year and it seems they're there every year.
But if someone else would see this, should they call the game? I think even the game commission says leave them alone.
Right.
They don't even want anybody to be
The biggest thing with ducks is they fall down sewers, you know, and they can't get up over curbs.
Mm.
So they walk down the curb line and end up towards the sewer. Once they're in the sewer, then it's a big...
You've seen videos,
many videos.
On social media, yeah, where people getting involved trying to save the mallards. I just want to show one more, and one really quick, a turtle. And I just want to remind people, if you see a turtle out on a road, tell people.
Okay, turtle, easiest way to rescue a turtle. Take it and get it off the road if you see it on the road. You almost have to stop immediately. Last year, I made the mistake. I was going pretty fast. I saw a turtle breast the edge of the road. By the time I turned around and came back, it got run over. And I couldn't believe it. I literally went a half a block, spun around, flew back, and the turtle was already smashed on the road. Get the turtle off the road. Another thing, set your mower a little high, or don't drive so fast on your mower that you can't see the turtle crossing your lawn. Right now, the grass is really high. If you cut the lawn really low and you run over a turtle, the turtle's done. You know, and they can live to be 30 years old.
I also wanted to mention real quick baby rabbits. If you can put that picture up, baby rabbits are in the lawn too, and you can run over them with a lawnmower. And this is basically saying, you know, leave them alone because the mom just comes back and feeds them twice a day.
Right.
So you need to leave them alone. If one gets out, gently put them back in the nest because the mom will bother with them just as birds. If you touch them, the parents will still...
Right.
It's not going to scare the parents away, but you want to leave the baby rabbits alone.
The mom plucks hair and lines the nest with hair. Sometimes the hair is sticking out of the lawn. That is a dead red flag. Stop and go and look. Inspect if there's babies in it. Cut around it. The vibration sometimes sends them flying out of the nest and underneath the mower. So,
I know.
And that's a horrible thing when you run over a baby rabbit.
I know. All right, You know, there's things we can do ourselves, and sometimes we need to call a wildlife rehabilitation specialist. And I guess if you don't know, I guess you contact different people, either the wildlife people or the shelter or the game commission, right, and see what they have to say if you don't know what to do. What do you think? Is that best?
That's best.
Okay.
Yep.
So, thank you.
Sure.
No problem. Thank you so much. Okay, I wanted to say that we're talking about rescuing animals. And I also want to talk about military animals who have rescued a lot of U.S. soldiers. And I just want to pay tribute to a lot of military animals here tonight. And I just want to start off by saying that military animals are very highly trained animals, and they are used in all branches of the armed services. And the U.S., the military has a variety of animals they use, and mainly I think we identify with military dogs. But they have used a lot of different animals over the years, and here are just a few that I want to pay tribute to here today. And first off is the horse. And if we could show the horse. Horses were used to transport troops, artillery. They were the most widely used animal for many years. The last time they were actively used, as far as I know, was after the 9/11 terrorist attacks. And there is a statue in New York City called Horse Soldiers, and it's a tribute to the horses in Afghanistan. And then next we have dolphins. Dolphins are used to detect bombs. The Navy uses them to find targets at depth or in murky water. Dolphins are extremely intelligent. They are better than any machine at detecting mines, and they can tag those underwater mines. They also can find unwanted divers or swimmers that don't belong in the United States waterways. Then we also have sea lions. And sea lions are also very smart, and they can find and retrieve equipment. They've find people who've been lost at sea. They also can identify intruders in restricted areas. Then we also have mules, and mules have carried supplies, equipment over difficult terrain. Like I said, they've used a lot of animals over the years. Then we also have pigeons, and pigeons are military messengers. That's G.I. Joe. And G.I. Joe's decorated pigeon, he saved a lot of lives in World War II, I believe it was. And he got his message sent to the pilots just in time before they're ready to take off to bomb a town in Italy. And by getting that, because they lost all communications, by this G.I. Joe getting to those pilots, he saved them from bombing and losing one. So he was honored, and after the war, he was actually, he's preserved at a place in New Jersey. And then I want to get to military dogs. And I have a video coming up playing tribute to them. But military dogs are highly trained dogs, and some of them cost $150,000 to train them. Military dogs were only recognized in World War II. And in World War II, Sergeant Stubby became very, very famous. He was a pit bull terrier, and he saved a lot of lives. Let's see, what else about military dogs? Military dogs were treated horribly, not in Vietnam. Actually, there's 5,000 canines, and they saved a lot of U.S. soldiers' lives. Unfortunately, most were just left behind in Vietnam, because the military saw them as equipment. So they were left behind or euthanized. And it's very, very sad, because they served our country, and in Vietnam, they eat dogs. So it is just so sad the way animals were treated. And so I would like to pay tribute to just the military dogs here, you know, for this Memorial Day. This tribute is for all the animals, but this is a special tribute for our military dogs. And please don't forget them this Memorial Day, this Monday, May 28th. And I'm sorry, I did not get the video of Sergeant Stubby out there. So enjoy this video. Thank you.
This dog, get in here! Get out! Get out of here!
We have 4 weeks to turn you into soldiers. At least he's ready.
Find a new buddy, Conroy?
The sergeant wanted a mascot. Give the unit a different look.
A different smell, too.
Hey, no!
Guess it's better to have every man and every dog we can get in this fight.
Well done, soldier.
Thank you, Sergeant.
I was talking to the dog.
What exactly are we going to be doing?
Take cover!
Now you Americans are here. It will be over soon.
Wounded! Coming to my back!
We must not let down our guard.
The dog is trying to warn us!
Stubby!
Get down!
I wish I had half his courage.
Courage? It's not courage.
I think this war has just improved.
Thank you, Stubby.
You could all learn something from him.
You are our hero, Stubby.
A close-up look at animal welfare issues is supported by AnimalWelfareIssues.com.